Well, hello people, so it's Peter here. Yes, down in the man shed for the first time in I don't know how many weeks, because maybe it shouldn't have been called a man shed, but a man sauna, okay? Because that's what it's been like, you know, since my last video, guys. I've not been able to come down here, not to play trains. Everything's hunky-dory in the shed, all my models and this, that and the other, but it was me. I couldn't stand it, you know. I mean, 30 odd degrees. I mean, even now it's coming up to 1 o'clock on the Monday, we're hitting 28 29 degrees now, so I'm going to keep this not too long. But I've got some trains running around anyway, but yeah, before it gets even hotter, because again we're up into the 30s. But there's something different today. We've got a bit of cloud and there's a breeze, which is very, very pleasant, and it just doesn't seem to be oppressive heat that it has been for the last fortnight down here. I couldn't stand it. I just kept on. I come down here in the evening when it was dark, had a little look in. Yeah, everything's hunky-dory, okay. Just start counting the spiders, see how many spiders have come out of the hiding, because the layout's not been running. I can't see any, so that's good. But anyway, yeah, so this is the first time I've actually got a couple of trains running today, but they're, touch wood, running sweet as. I'll show you my two trains going around, okay, in a second. But just to catch up with you and just to fill you in from what's happened from the last time, well, as I said, been doing nothing, it's too hot. So I'm afraid there's no running clips, guys, because I've not been down here. But just a reply to Michael Smith, he of the 40-foot layout up in the loft guy. He did ask me on my last video where I showed you the end of train lamp on the last wagon I did. He's saying, you know, what bits do you use, Pete? So I'll show you those bits that I use. They're from Illuminated Models and DCC Concepts. It's a mixture of what's needed to get it working. So I'll show you the little bits on that, Michael. I mean, there's one, the train that's running around at the moment is the Hatton 66 C-Mex pulling the Acura Scale rugby cement wagons. That's one of the last wagons that I haven't got a flashing lamp on yet, because I'm reluctant to do it, because that wagon, I mean, it's pristine, it's perfect, and yet I would have to sort of butcher it or try to find out how to take it apart in order to get the gubbins into it to try and fit an end of train lamp, which I'll show you what I did on the last wagon I did to show you what's needed to be done. But yeah, I'll do that. So I've got that going around. I've got a rail operations group, class 37, doing what it should be doing, pulling the passenger stop around, because that's what they do. And the guys, Euro-Phoenix, that's the company that owns these class 37s, all right? That's why you've got the Euro-Phoenix on the trains, and they're called Euro-Phoenix, and they're leased out to the rail operations group, okay? So at the moment in time, the Merlees Pioneer, the one that I've done a lot of work on to in make it look like how she is at the moment, she underwent tests on the main line, and she's still all worded up with the words Euro-Phoenix, you know, blazing down the side. But if it does then start going to work for a living, it could be leased to the rail operators group, and then they're going to want to put their own name down the side. So it might still mean that I've got to take the transfer off and then put the new one on. But don't know what's happening with her at the moment. She did successful trials on the main lines the other day, so but I'm still waiting to see what happens with that. Great Electric Train Show, all right, Milton Keynes. I've got my tickets and I've got my accommodation.
Yes.
All right, so I think it's the Hilton, where quite a number of us are all staying on the Saturday night. There's quite a few YouTubers, I believe, getting there. I think Alan of Dragon Junction, I think Tony Northeastern. Robert of Robert's Train Set is coming up on the Saturday only. But, you know, hopefully there'll be a good old gathering again of people, you know, that we got together last year. Hopefully the same thing will happen again today, this time round. Because Alan, I've seen, you know, you've been doing videos, you've been quite active, and you had a fantastic birthday and a birthday outing, and then you've been posting models, you know, what's been going on with your layout and fixes and your new model and everything. So you've been very active. You've been able to get down to the old layout, unlike me. Robert had a new Robert's train set had a new loco he treated himself to, and he braved the conditions up in the loft, nearly melted, just to just to make sure that the loco actually worked. So well done to you, Robert. Gosh, that must have been unbearable, but well done. And I'm pleased to say it does look like it's all working. You had to do a fix, and it seems to have worked very well. And, you know, as people say, you shouldn't have to do the fix. But what can you do? But still, it's a bit like Manhattan 66s. Yes, I shouldn't have had to do that, but they're now fabulous trains. You know, they're all working 100%. And in a way, to offset that, don't forget, Hatton's discounted them, you know, incredibly at the end in order to shift the stock. They really, you know, I mean, you was getting 100 quid loco, you know. So for that, to do a little bit of working on and then to find out, you know, your train is running perfectly, well, you know, I'm more than happy. So anyway, so yeah. And now the other thing about Milton Keynes is, as you know, I belong to a model railway club, or you may not have known, called the Beckenham and West Wickham Model Railway Club. Greg Marshall is our chairman, and Greg builds layouts and by himself and also in together with the club. And we've got a layout up in at Getz. All right, we are the guests of Hornby magazine, and we're going to have a layout up there called Beckwick. And Beckwick is a southern region sort of country station terminus, third rail, so all the third rails being laid for all the track and everything, and very nice, you know. So yeah, it's a nice little southern region train station, you know, an end terminus station. So quite a lot of activity of the old all the trains coming in. We've even got the Brighton Bell that I remember running last time we had it at an exhibition. So yeah, the electrified version of it, because that's what it is. It's that era. But yeah, love it. It's a great layout. It's really nice. And then the other one is Greg's latest addition, Gordon's Lane, which I think is he calls it the Wessex Main Line. I'm just checking on it, guys. I'm just looking up. Yes, Wessex Main Line layout. Okay, Gordon's Lane. He's called it. So that's the one you might have seen a video put on. It's just the scenic section is just a bit like what Peter Waltman's doing, you know, just a nice long section of straight track where you just see the trains running at their main lines train speed. So it's nice because it's just trains running. It's lovely, you know, even though it's got a little siding to put the cleaning maintenance vehicles and things like that. They've got a little maintenance shed and everything, so a little bit of interest in the foreground. But that's not going to be there, but Beckwick is. But yeah, so we're the guests of Hornby magazine. So although I'm going there off my own back, I will be wearing my club t-shirt and everything, because my guys are there, all right? So that's rather nice. And, you know, Greg's had the two layouts that I talked about actually featured in the Hornby magazine 1 month after the other. So yeah, that's, how about that? That's not bad, is it? So yeah, so that's that'd be the gets. So again, maybe a bit more nearer the time, but that's what's happened. I'm definitely on the cards to go. I've got me tickets. I've got me accommodation. So fantastic. Right, enough with the nattering. And I may sort of call it a halt, because it's getting warm. So I will stop. I'll just show Michael these little bits and pieces I've used. I'll just turn the camera around in a second, and you can see the trains running around, sweet as. But that's it for now, guys, all right? So, you know, I'm still watching your videos. I mean, not a lot of people have posted because it has been so hot, you know, and even in the old garden layout, the shed, it was unbearable. I couldn't stand it. So, sorry, no more running clips other than, you know, what this video is, until next time, okay? All right, so that's it. Peter, signing out for now before it gets too hot. Hopefully we get a bit of rain today, so the next few days, the garden needs it. But until next time, guys, everything's all hunky-dory, it's all well, and I hope the world is well with you guys too. So until next time, all right, bye for now, bye-bye. Right, Michael, so these are the bits I used to create this and the train lamp on this wagon here. These I got from Model U. These are 3D printed Ender train lamps, but of course, you know, they are as they are. You've got to drill out where you're going to put your LED, so a bit fiddly, my friend, unless you do get the LEDs from DCC Concepts, the complete thing, because there they are, they're already with the LEDs already fitted. I would use the lamps, and I've used this in the past, but I don't use this equipment now. It's, to me, it's well over the top for what's needed for an Ender train lamp. You know, the electronics they've used, far, far too complicated in my opinion, because instead of all the gubbins that comes in there where they tell you to try and make it work by a magnet, so it's a hall switch. No, admittedly the lamps are fantastic, but the circuitry overcomplicated. Illuminated models, this is what you need if you just got a flashing LED. You can see the terminals at each side. One says LED at this end, the other end says power. Doesn't matter which way the power gets soldered onto this board, it does matter which way the LED gets soldered on, alright, because LEDs are plus and minus specific, aren't they? So alright, so you've got to work that out. There's that tiny little board there, doesn't take up a lot of room, but it hasn't got a capacitor, so therefore if it doesn't have a constant supply, you will get outage on your flashing train lamp. So what they come up with, this rather larger one, same thing again, you've got two circuits, LEDs to those solder pads this side and the power to this side, but this one is fitted with the capacitor. All right. And that's what I've used on this loco there. So this is illuminated models. If you buy any one of those two, it does come with a flashing LED. That's how you can make the LED look once you've drilled out one of these lamps and fitted the LED back into the back and held it in place with super glue or whatever. You can see the wiring that needs to be attached. That's another one ready to go. How did I do it on this wagon? So the LED, yeah, obviously comes down, the wiring goes down underneath, and because it's got the capacitor, you use what I use from the DCC supplies are these pickup, I think you can get them off of eBay as well, but these come from DCC supplies. What you can see is I've got one glued just behind where the coupling would be. So picking up from the backs of these two wheels, and that's all you need, because I've got the one with the capacitor, don't need to have more than these two. Any outages is taken up with the capacitor. So obviously the wiring is all going down, drill a hole through the wagon, black tack is just holding all the tape back, doesn't matter, you know, it goes around the track perfectly because it's very thin wire, doesn't obstruct the mechanism whatsoever. And then of course, because it's got a load, the load in this question is a resin 3D printed version of the 08 engine, which of course is hollow, and so therefore this bit of gubbins is actually sitting inside the engine. Okay, so all the wiring disappearing inside goes up into there, and yes, only two pickups, but that's all that's needed, because this capacitor does the job of keeping the flashing alive. I demonstrated it before, didn't I? You take it off the track and it still flashes for 30 seconds. So fantastic. So no wiring to be seen at all on the inside of the wagon. All hidden away discreetly. You can't see it at all from the side. And the only thing that gives it away a little bit is maybe the wiring coming down from underneath the lamp where it is drilled through the bodywork there to go underneath there. All right, so yeah, all right, so that's where the wiring from the lamp. So there you are, Michael. So really straightforward. If you're, these are the other means, if you can't use that, you can use either, again, illuminated models. You know, these are the copper wiping strips that they sell if you want to pick up, and this one would be great for a bogey, because you can pick up on that pair of wheels on the bogey and that pair of wheels on the bogey, and that should be okay to use that circuitry with, because you should get constant pickup from either each side, you know. So that's their version. Or again, DCC Concepts, and this is hard to pick up, do this spring that goes, you know, you have to take your wheel apart and you put it over the axle. So if you've got one side of your wheel on your bogies, on your wheel set is live, then that means that the shaft is live as well, and then the other wheel will be insulated. Well, by having this on the shaft, and then you solder to the bit at the end here, you solder to that spring, not the easiest to spring to solder to. That's how you can pick up the current there. But you would need two, one on each axle, all right? One picking up current from one side, the other one picking up current on the other side. So that's how I've used as a mixture of, getting the electrical current to the circuitry board and all the rest of it. And then, but that's what I want to try to think about doing on my cement wagons. But they're a Curascale cement wagon, so they're in absolute, pristine condition, and they're perfect. And a lot of, there's a lot of work that I don't want to do to, end up having a ruined wagon at the end of the day. So I do take quite a long time before I do these things.
So going around, at the moment we have two trains. We have the C-Mex putting the cement wagons, and we've got the rail operators group putting a Class 350.
And as you can see, absolutely spot on. 15 tankers, not a wobble, nothing, absolutely blinding. All fixed with the old magnetic couplings, guys, including this 350. These are fitted with elite couplings on the older train, whereas the cement wagons are fitted with the old Hunt couplings. But no issues whatsoever. Fantastic. It's such a help for me to get those 15 wagons off when I want to. But yeah, there you go. I mean, sweet as a nut, guys. The layout's running well. Just turn the sound off so that I can talk to you. And what else to show you? Yeah, up there, let's lift you up a little bit. Well, that's the reason why I was worried about the loft, the shed. Plastic models galore everywhere, guys, okay? And, there's so much of it. Behind the curtains, continues on storage there. Continues behind the back scene there, the shelving that goes behind the back scene. There's more models. More models up there on the shelves up there, all different scales. And I can't show you it, but it's underneath the layout, behind the curtains there. Again, there are models hidden away underneath there. And of course, that's what I was worried about in the heat. Not only is the layout running well, but are those models okay? You know, all the plastic and whatever. You know, will I come back to find there's a wing drooping down? But no, it's all good. So a big F-16 there, but no, it's all good. I have done a video in the past showing you some of these, my other interest. This is what I was doing before I got back into the trains again. I some of these models are built, some are bought, all sorts and all different scales as well. But no. Homes of spiders at the moment, I'm sad to say, but they're okay, they're not ruined. And if it keeps the spiders off of there, then that's fair enough. And then no spiders around at the moment. I mean, I'm surprised. I thought they might all be taking advantage of a very quiet shed, that they'd all be coming down. And but no, the trains haven't had to run over any spiders. They normally hide in there, underneath the estate there. Get a loco go in. When it comes out, it's got spiders web all over the front of it, so they hide in there. So I don't know what I would find if I have to get to the inside there, which I can do, but I don't, try and leave it alone as much as possible. But all running sweet as. And that's the one I want to try and put an ender train lamp on. It's got a dummy one at the moment, but Yeah, this one. Whereas this one coming around was a very easy one to do, because obviously the 350, when it was a working train, had got electrical pickups for its own lighting that it had when it was its own train. And there she is flashing away at the back, so that has got an end of train lamp on it, prototypically. Doesn't matter about the pantograph on the top, it's not a powered train, it's being dragged by the 37, that's what they do in the real life. So she could be... getting pulled to be somewhere else in operation, or, you know, hopefully not to scrap, it's too new to be scrapped. Anyway, alright guys. Catch you next time. So it's bye from Peter down in the old man shed at a more comfortable temperature now. All the best, people. Take care. If I don't see you, I'll see you at Getz. Yes? If I don't see you beforehand. Bye for now. Bye-bye.